Okay, if you would, open your Bible today to John, I should say, open your Bible today to Romans chapter 6. Romans chapter 6. And let's begin reading in verse 1. Romans chapter 6, verse 1 says, "What shall we say then? Shall we continue in sin that grace may abound? God forbid. How shall we that are dead to sin live any longer therein? Know ye not that so many of us as were baptized into Jesus Christ were baptized into his death?" Keeping in mind, that's Holy Spirit baptism. It's not water. Because water baptism cannot do for you what this baptism does for you. "Therefore we are buried with him by baptism into death, that like as Christ was raised up from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we also should walk in newness of life. For if we've been planted together in the likeness of his death, we shall be also in the likeness of his resurrection, knowing this, that our old man is crucified with him, that the body of sin might be destroyed, that henceforth we should not serve sin, for he that is dead is freed from sin. Now if we be dead with Christ, we believe that we shall also live with him, knowing that Christ, being raised from the dead, dieth no more. Death had no more dominion over him. For in that he died unto sin once, but in that he liveth unto God. Likewise, reckon you also yourselves to be dead indeed unto sin, but alive unto God through Jesus Christ our Lord. Let not sin therefore reign in your mortal body, that you should obey it in the lust thereof. Neither yield ye your members as instruments of unrighteousness unto sin, but yield yourselves unto God as those who are alive from the dead, and your members as instruments of righteousness unto God. For sin shall not have dominion over you, for you are not of the law, but under grace. What then? Shall we sin because we're none of the law, but under grace? God forbid. Know you not that to whom you yield yourselves service to obey, his service you are to whom you obey, whether of sin unto death, or of obedience unto righteousness? But God be thanked that ye were his service of sin, but you have obeyed from the heart that form of doctrine which was delivered you. Being then made free from sin, you became the service of righteousness. I speak after the manner of men, because of the infirmity of your flesh, for as ye have yielded your members service to uncleanness, and to iniquity unto iniquity, even so now yield your members as service to righteousness unto holiness. For when you were the service of sin, you were free from righteousness. What fruit had you then in those things whereof you are now ashamed? For the end of those things is death. But now being made free from sin and become service to God, you have your fruit unto holiness and the end everlasting life. For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord." Now, as I mentioned to you last week, this chapter here, Romans 6, is what I call it a radical chapter, a radical chapter. And there are many chapters like that in the Bible. And radical chapters in the Bible are chapters that just seem to stand out above the rest. Now, you know, all the chapters of the Bible are important, and they're all inspired of God. But there's some that stand out above the rest because they say things that are contrary to what most people believe. They go against the grain. They contradict modern thought. They say the opposite of what most people believe and think. Some of these radical chapters destroy many pet doctrines that people have believed for years. And also these radical chapters sometimes wreck the religious traditions of men. And some of these chapters are so radical that even after people read them, they still don't believe them. Romans 6 is a radical chapter because it says things about sin and salvation that most people don't believe today. For many years, we've been taught that nobody can have complete victory over sin in this life. We've been taught that we must struggle and strive to gain victory over sin. And we've been taught that as long as we're in the flesh, we're going to sin as if we must sin or have no other choice but to sin. And we've been taught to believe that sin is too big of a giant for us to overcome in this life. And according to most Christians, salvation and deliverance from the power of sin is gained by struggle, striving, and they say complete victory over sin is not possible. But yet Romans 6 says that Christ not only died to save us from sin's penalty, but he died to save us from sin's power. They're both connected. And think about it. Why would he die to save you from the penalty of sin and not die to save you from sin's power? I mean, would it make sense for Christ to die to save you from sin's penalty, but then leave it up to you to save yourself from sin's power? I mean, didn't God know you could not save yourself from the penalty of sin? Yes, he did. And didn't he know you could not save yourself from the power of sin? Yes, he did. Well, if so, doesn't it make sense that he died to save you from both the penalty and power of sin? Folks, Romans 6 tells us that God saved us from the power of sin, and we're saved from the power of sin the same way we're saved from the penalty of sin, and it's by grace, through faith, by the death and resurrection of Christ. Romans 6 says that Christ's death and resurrection, which is mentioned many times in this chapter, he says in Romans 6 that Christ's death and resurrection saved us from both the penalty and the power of sin. Therefore, we do not have to strive and struggle to be saved from either the penalty or the power of sin either. Now, today, we're going to pick up where we left off last week in verse 9. We'll begin in Romans chapter 6, verse 9 and 10 and 11, which says, knowing that Christ, being raised from the dead, dieth no more. Death hath no more dominion over him. For in that he died unto sin once, but in that he liveth unto God. Likewise, in other words, like him. Likewise, reckon ye also yourselves to be dead indeed unto sin, but alive unto God through Jesus Christ our Lord. Now Paul says, reckon yourself to be dead and raised with Christ. The word reckon, it simply means to count something to be true. Count it to be true. In this verse, we are to count and reckon that what is true of Christ is true of us. Therefore, when Christ died, we died with him. And being raised, we were raised with him. You see, his death and resurrection is counted as ours as if it really and actually happened to us. Reckon it to be true of you what is said of him. When he died, you died with him. When he was buried, you were buried with him. And when he was resurrected, you were resurrected with him. Now, why is that important? Why is it important for us to reckon ourselves to be dead and raised with Christ? Well, it's important when you consider his death and resurrection and what is said about his death and resurrection in Romans 6. In Romans 6, here's what we learn. When Christ died, he died under the sin he became on the cross. Our sins were imputed to Christ on the cross. as if he committed them instead of us. He bore our sins in his own body on the tree. Sin cursed him on the cross. He came under the dominion of sin on the cross. God made him to be sin for us on the cross. But in death, he was released from the curse of sin. He was freed from sin's grip. He was delivered from sin's dominion. He was freed from the sin he became when he died, because he that is dead is freed from sin. Christ became sin for us on the cross, but when he died for sin, he was freed from sin, because he that is dead is free from sin. Now, when he was raised from the dead, it says here, he began to live unto God. He began to live unto God free from the sin that bound him on the cross. Now, there never was a time that Christ did not live unto God. But in the days of his flesh, he did so under the continual burden of sin that was laid on him. But now that he lives unto God, he lives unchallenged by the claims of sin. Sin has no claim whatsoever on him today. In the flesh, it did. He lived under the continual burden of sin and died under the curse of sin. But when he was resurrected free from that sin he became. And in resurrection, he no longer had to put up with that burden of sin that he carried in the flesh. He was raised free to serve God, free from the sin that burdened him and bound him on the cross. Raised free to serve God. Now, we're told, verse 9, 10, 11, we're told to reckon the same thing to be true of us as it is of Christ. What's true of him? True of you. As he died unto sin, we're to reckon ourselves dead to sin. Now, when Christ died, he died unto sin, and because we died with him, we're to reckon ourselves dead unto sin. And as Christ became free from sin when he died, we're to count ourselves free from sin, having died with Christ. And being dead to sin, we're free from its power. You see, sin's power, dominion, stranglehold on us was broken and destroyed according to verse 5 and 6. We talked about that last week. Now, being raised with Christ, we are raised into a new life from the sin that dominated our lives prior to being crucified with Christ. We're raised, Paul said, to walk in newness of life, a life that sin has no dominion over. It's a life of victory, a life of victory and not defeat. Then look at verse 12, Romans 6, 12. He says, let not sin, therefore. You know the word therefore means it refers to what's been said before. Let not sin, therefore, view of what I've said, reign in your mortal body, that you should obey it, sin, in the lust thereof. Now, this is written to us in view of what he said to us in verse 1 through 11. That verse is written to people who are dead to sin and are raised to walk in newness of life. And that verse tells us something. It tells us a lot. But one thing it tells us is this: sin has not been eradicated from our body. It has not been eradicated from our body. His power over us has been destroyed, but sin is still present in the body. But even though sin is still present, we can have the victory over him Because God said, let not sin reign in your mortal body. And he also said, sin shall not have dominion over you. Now listen, prior to being saved, sin reigned over us as a king. He reigned as king over our mortal body. You see, our body was his empire. And he controlled all the members of our body. They could not resist his power over him. But now that God has cut us loose from sin, his power over us has been destroyed. God cut the link that bound you to sin. You are free from him, and he is no longer the king of your life. And when we walk in newness of life, we live in freedom from the reign of sin. Sin does not reign over those who walk in newness of life. You say, well, Brother Art, if that's true, then why do Christians still sin? Why does sin still reign over many Christians? I'll tell you why. Because many of them do not know that they're free from sin. They don't know it. They don't know that God has cut them loose from sin. They still think that their relationship to sin is the same as it was before they were saved. They think it's impossible to live in victory over sin, and so they live in defeat. You know, Jesus one time said, you shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. But suppose you don't know the truth, or you don't believe the truth. Well, if you don't know the truth, if you don't believe the truth about our victory over sin, you'll never be free. You'll always live in defeat or half victories. Freedom from sin is something we must reckon to be true by faith. Something you got to believe and reckon to be true by faith. Paul said, we just read it a moment ago. He said, reckon, count it as true. Reckon you also yourself to be dead indeed unto sin. You do that by faith. To reckon something is to count it to be true and count it to be true in spite of how you feel. See, that's what faith is. Faith reckons what God says to be true even though your feelings say the opposite. The problem with most Christians is that when it comes to the old nature of sin, they don't believe they're free from it. They don't believe they're free from it. Because they don't feel like they're free from it. They still think and feel that as long as they live in these mortal bodies, they're going to sin as if they're destined to sin and cannot help but to sin. And as long as a Christian thinks and feels that way, sin will always have dominion over them. You see, sin reigns supreme over those who don't know or believe they're free from sin. Sin reigns over those who think that as long as they're in the flesh, they can't help but to sin. And sin reigns over those who think it's up to them to gain the victory over sin by their own works. And sin reigns over those who base what they believe about sin on their feelings. But folks, sin does not reign over those who know and believe that God has set them free from the power of sin and that sin does not have dominion over them. Sin does not reign over those who believe the victory over sin has already been won. And sin does not reign over those who have surrendered themselves to God for the victory instead of trying to gain the victory themselves. They know the victory over sin has already been won by Christ on the cross and not by their self-efforts. Sin does not reign over them because they don't base what they believe about sin on how they feel. They base it upon what God says in spite of how they feel. Folks, let me tell you something. Your feelings are unreliable because your feelings will tell you you cannot defeat sin. Your feelings will tell you that victory over sin is not possible in these mortal bodies. That's what your feelings will tell you. They'll tell you victory over sin is impossible as long as you live in a mortal body. That's why you cannot listen to your feelings. Listen to the Word of God. Ignore the feelings. That's what faith is. Let me put it like this. If you're truly saved and you know it, you do not live in fear of dying and going to hell, do you? No. Why not? Because you know and believe that God saved you from sin's penalty by the death and resurrection of His Son. Well, if you don't live in fear of suffering sin's penalty, then why live in subjection to sin's power? Listen, folks, when Christ died to save you from sin's penalty, He also died to save you from sin's power. And if you can trust God for one, why not trust and believe Him for the other? Why let a defeated foe reign over you? Sin is not your king anymore. So why allow him to reign over you? Why don't you reign over him? You say, Brother Watkins, you think it's possible for me to reign over sin? Folks, I flat believe it's possible. Look at Romans chapter 5, 17. Look at it. One chapter back, Romans 5, 17. Look what it says. For by one man's offense, that's Adam, death reigned by one, not only death, but sin also. Much more, they, that's me and you, which receive abundance of grace and of the gift of righteousness, shall do what? Right. Shall reign in life by one, Jesus Christ. Now that verse right there says that you and I reign in life. What do we reign over? I tell you what, sin and death that once reigned over us. That's what. You say, how is that possible? By one, Jesus Christ. You see, He's the one that won the victory over sin and death for us. He's the one that dethroned sin and death over our lives. You see, in Adam, sin and death reigns over all. In Christ, you and I reign over both. So is it possible for you to reign over sin instead of sin reigning over you? Yes, it is. Paul said we reign in life. We reign in life over the things that reign over us or once reigned over us, and one of them was sin. That's why Paul said, let not sin reign in your mortal body. Instead, you reign over it. Don't let him be your king. He's not your king anymore. Don't let a defeated foe reign over you or lead you to believe he's still king. No, folks, that king's been dethroned. God kicked him off the throne. Look at verse 13. Neither yield ye your members as instruments of unrighteousness unto sin, but yield yourselves unto God as those who are alive from the dead, and your members as instruments of righteousness unto God. Now look at verse 19. I speak after the manner of men, because of the infirmity of your flesh, for as you have yielded your members service to uncleanness, and to iniquity unto iniquity, even so now yield your members service to righteousness unto holiness. I've read these together because they're almost saying the same thing. Now, the commands that God gives us in these verses were impossible for us to keep prior to being set free from the power of sin. Prior to being saved from sin's power, sin had total control over every member of our body, and he used them as instruments of unrighteousness and iniquity. Sin was king in your life. He was the master. He was supreme leader of every member of your body. And he used the members of your body as a tool and even a weapon of war against the God that created your body. Think about that. Prior to being saved, sin used this body as a weapon to fight against the God that made these bodies. He dominated us, ruled over us. He ruled over the members, all the members of our bodies, and used them as instruments of unrighteousness and to fight against the very God that created these bodies. And brother, I can say amen to that. I know. But listen, that's past history. That's past history. Sin has been taken off the throne. He is no longer the supreme leader. He is no longer king. He's no longer the master. By the death and resurrection of Christ, God set you free from the power and control of sin. And now we are in control of our bodies, and we can use these bodies in the way in God intended for them to be used, and that is to glorify Him. You know, one of the main reasons why God set us free from sin's power and dominion is so we can start using these bodies to do what God created them to do, and that is to praise and honor Him instead of ourselves. That's the practical side of being set free from sin. God created these bodies and each member of them to serve Him, honor Him, work for Him, please Him in the world. That's why God created the physical body. But what happened? Sin defeated God's purpose. But Christ's death and resurrection redeemed us, reclaimed us when He saved us. And when He saved us, He not only saved us from hell, but He saved us for service. And how do we serve God? In these bodies. You know what? You cannot serve God without using your body to do it. It's impossible. And God saved you for service. I want to quote a couple of verses to you. Verses you probably know or ought to know. Ephesians 2:10 says, "We are His workmanship, created in Christ Jesus unto good works, which God had before ordained that we should walk in them." In Titus 2:14, Christ gave Himself for us that He might redeem us from all iniquity and purify unto Himself a people zealous of good works. Now, folks, every good work that God ordained for us to do is done in these bodies. But how could we do the good works that God ordained and saved us to do in a body under bondage to sin? If sin reigned over us as a king, we could not possibly do the good works that God ordained for us to do in these bodies. Sin would not let us. That's why God took sin off the throne of our lives so we could start serving Him in these bodies without interference. That's why Paul said, "I can do all things through Christ that strengthens me." How does Christ strengthen us? I tell you how. By setting us free from sin and coming to dwell in us. And this is why we can do everything God told us to do. Right now, friend, if you're saved, you have the power and the liberty and the ability to use every member of your body in full-time service for the Lord. I mean, He said, verse 13 and 14, "Neither yield ye your members as instruments of unrighteousness unto sin, but yield yourselves unto God as those that are alive from the dead, and your members as instruments of righteousness unto God. In verse 19, he says, "For as you have yielded your members service to uncleanness and to iniquity unto iniquity, even so now yield your members service to righteousness unto holiness." You know what this also means? We cannot use sin anymore as an excuse for failing to do the job that God gave us to do. Can't use sin no more. We can't say, "Well, you know what? I'd like to witness. I'd like to pray. I'd like to be a good example. I'd like to live godly. But sin, the old nature, just won't let me." You can't say that anymore. Can't use sin as an excuse anymore. God dethroned him. God cut you loose from him. He's still there, but you don't have to serve him anymore. Verse 14. Tell you what, this verse right here, Romans 6:14, is one of the most powerful verses in the New Testament when it comes to the issue of the power of sin in our lives. And it plainly says, "For sin shall not have dominion over you, for you're not of the law, but under grace." He said, sin shall not have dominion over you. Why? You're not under the law, but under grace. In other words, we're not under the law that says, do. We're under grace that says, done. You see, grace excludes works from having anything to do with our freedom from the dominion of sin. The victory over sin is already ours, and we don't have to struggle and strive to get the victory. You don't even have to pray. The victory was won by Christ on the cross. What we need to do is live in the victory we already have. And I tell you what, if you try and, quote, gain the victory over sin by your works, you live in defeat. But when you start believing you already have victory over sin by grace through Christ, then you'll start living in victory instead of defeat. Let's look at it like this. You were saved from sin's penalty by grace and not works. And it's not up to you to keep yourself from suffering the penalty of sin. It's up to Christ to save and keep you saved from sin's penalty. It's his responsibility. It's his duty. In the same way, we're saved from sin's power by grace and not works. Therefore, it's not up to us to save ourselves from the power of sin either. You know what? You couldn't do it before you were saved. What makes you think you can do it now? Listen, folks, we're saved from both the penalty and power of sin by grace. And grace excludes works on our part. It's up to Christ to save us from both. And he did it once for all time when he died and was resurrected. It's by grace, see, not works. You know, most people would agree that they're saved by grace when it comes to the penalty of sin, and that they don't have to strive and work to keep themselves saved from the penalty of sin. It's by grace, it's a gift. They'll agree with that. But how about the power of sin? You're saved from sin's power by grace also. It's something God did for you. It's not something you do. It's something he did. It's already been done. The victory's already been won. You say, "Well, Brother Watkins, I don't feel like it. I just don't feel like I'm free from sin. I don't feel like that. I feel like sin has dominion over me." I wonder where those feelings come from. They don't come from God, do they? God says you're free from sin. He says you don't have to serve him. He says sin shall not have dominion over you. And so if you feel like, you know, that's not true of you, I'll guarantee you those feelings didn't come from God. They came from the old man or the devil or the world. Verse 17, 18. "But God be thanked that you were the servants of sin, but you have obeyed from the heart that form of doctrine which was delivered you, being then made free from sin, you became the servants of righteousness. Now, it appears to me in this verse that the Roman saints believed the doctrine of Romans 6. They obeyed from the heart what Paul said in this chapter about victory over sin. And by believing that doctrine, their lives were changed. They went from being the servants of sin to becoming servants of righteousness. They stopped serving sin. They stopped allowing sin to reign over them. They no longer allowed sin to have dominion over their mortal bodies. They yielded the members of their bodies as instruments of praise and honor and holiness and glory unto the God that created them. I mean, he said, you've obeyed from the heart. That form of doctrine delivered you, and being then made free from sin, you became the servants of righteousness. So evidently, the doctrine of Romans 6 revolutionized their lives. Not just the doctrine of salvation by grace from sin's penalty, but salvation by grace from sin's power also. They saw that both were by grace and not works, and that both had already been won by the death and resurrection of Christ, and that they did not have to struggle and strive to gain either one. Now, folks, let me tell you something. This is what saints today need to see and know. What I've said here today and what Romans 6 says. They need to know it. They need to see it. And until they do, they'll never live in true victory over sin as they should and as they can. I want to tell you a story that I've told before. I'm telling it again because it works. You know, when I find a tool that works, I don't throw it away. I keep using it. How about you? Years ago, I saw this dog in a housing project in Foley. And this dog was tied to a tree with a chain. And that chain was about 6 foot out from the tree. And all day long, that dog, chained to that tree, walked around that tree. He walked one way, and then he'd unbind himself and walk the other way all day long. That's all he did. Tied to the tree. Couldn't get free. And that dog wore out a circle around that tree. Had a perfect circle around that tree where he walked and walked and walked, tied to the tree. And the life of that dog was confined to the length of his chain. He could go no further than that chain allowed him to go. His life, his movements were dominated by that chain. But you know what? One day I looked out there and his collar had slipped off. He was free from the chain. But you know what? He still remained in that small area around that tree. He didn't walk away from the tree. The dog was free and didn't know it. He did not know that he could go anywhere he wanted. You know what? That dog could have traveled for miles and miles if he wanted to. But he thought he was still bound to the tree and that it was not possible for him to go beyond the boundaries of that tree and that chain. He didn't think it was possible. Now, he saw other dogs that were free. I mean, they walked by all day long. They were free. But he did not think he was free. He lived in bondage when he could have lived as a free dog. He got so used to the chain that he did not think it was possible to live any other way. Does that sound familiar? Listen, there are thousands of Christians just like that dog. Before they were saved, they were bound by sin. Sin controlled their life. Sin reigned supreme over their lives. But when they got saved, God not only set them free from the penalty of sin, but the power of sin. He cut the chain. Sin does not have dominion over them anymore. the power that sin had over them was destroyed. They don't have to serve sin anymore. Sin does not have dominion over them anymore. But you know what? Even though they're free from sin, they still act and think the same way they did before they were saved. They don't believe anybody can have complete victory over sin in their lives. And they struggle to gain the victory, and they fail over and over again. They have been led to believe that as long as they're in the flesh, they're going to sin, and that we can gain only partial victory over sin and not total victory. And so they live in constant defeat instead of victory. They're just like that dog. Well, I'm here to tell you something today, folks. You can live in victory instead of defeat. I can say upon the authority of Romans 6 that Christ not only died to deliver you from the penalty of sin, but the power of sin. But the power of sin, by his death and shed blood, in other words, by Christ's death and by his shed blood, you're not only saved from sin's penalty in hell, the lake of fire, but you're also saved from the power of sin. And I say if you can believe one, you ought to believe the other. I'm here to tell you that you are free from sin. That's what it says. I can tell you that sin does not have dominion over you. That's what it says. And I can tell you that you can stop sin from reigning over you from this day forward. And I'm here to tell you that Christ has saved and delivered you from the power of sin, and you don't have to stay chained to that tree anymore. You're free. Christ won the victory for you. So why not enjoy it now and quit struggling to do what you can't really do in the flesh? I tell you what, we're doomed to defeat as long as we think victory over sin is by works. As long as you believe that, you'll never win. You know, a person can never really be saved from the penalty of sin so long as he believes he must do something along with believing to be saved. God will never save him. Same thing is true about the power of sin. As long as you think that it's up to you to gain the victory over the power of sin, you'll never win. Folks, the victory's already been won. Christ cut the chain a long time ago. Don't be like that dog and sit there thinking that you're not free when you are. Get up and move. Get away from that tree. See? I say to you today, maybe you're not aware of what you've heard here in the last couple of weeks. Maybe you're chained to that tree like that dog. You think you are, but you're not if you're saved. My advice to you is this. Why not pray today? Pray and say, Lord, you said I'm free from sin. And you said that sin shall not have dominion over me. And even though I don't feel like it, I'm going to believe you meant what you said. And from this day forward, I'm going to surrender myself to you and start believing you have already gained the victory for me. And I'm going to live in the victory that's already been won for me. And I know I can, because you live in me and the victory is yours. See, folks, Jesus Christ, listen, God has not only set you free from that chain, he's not only destroyed that power that sin had over you, but he's done something else. He put his Son in you also. Christ in you, Paul said, the hope of glory. And Paul said, I can do all things through Christ that strengthens me. He's always in you and with you. And listen, you show me one sin that Jesus Christ cannot defeat. He defeats them all. And you can defeat them all. You don't have to live under bondage of sin. You're free from it. Don't believe the devil. Don't believe the world. And don't listen to the old nature that says, well, as long as you're in the flesh, you've got to sin. That's a lie. You don't have to. You go home today and you consider Romans chapter 6 again. Read it carefully. And not only that, but if you like to restudy this a little bit more carefully, a little bit slower, tell me and I'll give you both CDs of this message. There's two of them. You listen to it again. You check out what I say by the scriptures. Don't take it from me, search and see. Get them down, listen to them, and I think you'll agree with me when God said, sin shall not have dominion over you. And so don't think it does, and don't live like it does either. Live the way God wants you to live, and that's free from the dominion and power and influence of sin in your life. You can have the victory. Why? Because the victory is already yours. Christ won it for you. It's not up to you. He's already done it. Why try and do what's already been done? See? Let us pray. Father, I pray for all the members of this church, God, that's heard the message, and those that are listening by radio or video. I pray you'd help each one to understand what they've heard today and last week. And I realize, God, a lot of this is new to some people. And God, I know it's hard sometimes for us to believe these things because we rely upon our flesh and feelings. But God, I pray you might give us that faith to believe that what you said in these verses is true. We do have victory over sin. Sin does not have dominion over us. And we can stop sin from reigning in our bodies, and we can actually reign over sin ourselves. You said it. God, help us all to believe it and live like it. In Jesus' name, amen.